I'm going to call this meeting to order, and I have to add to our agenda Recreation Board, number 9, for payment. And then a few things came in for correspondence for information, and we'll go over those later on. But with that, we have our minutes from May 11th and May 20th.
I would move that we approve the select board minutes from the May 11th and the May 20th meetings.
Okay.
Can we do them both at once?
I'm wondering if you can
separate them.
Yeah.
So you could vote on.
Yeah.
Okay, so I will amend that.
Okay.
And say I'd like to move that we approve the select board minutes from the May 11th meeting.
I'll second that.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I'll move now that we approve the minutes from the May 20th meeting.
That's the bridge, right?
Yes, that's the bridge.
Okay.
I should vote. Is it okay if I move?
Well, I'll just move we approve the minutes from May 20th.
Okay.
Okay. I'll second.
All right. Good. Any discussion?
Get this straight.
Yep. Any discussion? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 I'll abstain.
Okay. Great. Okay. Sign those. Then we go to bills for payment. We have to ratify warrant 23A, and that was a school payment of $365,706.04, and that had to be paid before the meeting. So we ratify that. Then we have warrant 24. We have the payroll 24P. We have from the cemetery fund, number 7 for tree removal. Conservation Commission is in there for number 10. And then the Recreation Board, baseball supplies, number 9.
So I'll move that we approve for payment and ratify warrant 23A, warrant 24, warrant 24P. Cemetery Fund number 7, Conservation Commission number 10, and Recreation Board number 9.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, any discussion? Okay, under warrant 24, we have $11,552.40. That is going towards health insurance, retirement funds for employees, tires for the international truck, there's some gravel, electric bills, the sheriff's monthly bill, they put in 24 hours last month, and we drew down the balance in the emergency management fund, I understand, and bought some new traffic cones. And there's also some fuel. So, any other comments? All those in favor, then?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All right. Then we move on to recognition of visitors and public comments. And if you're here to comment on something further down the agenda, you can wait. But if you have some other burning issue you'd like to bring up.
No, it's been really nice watching you on video over these past few weeks.
Oh, yeah.
You do have a fan base, right?
Yeah.
Yes, our mailbag is usually, you know, full. We have an international following. Thank you.
I'm going to move this along.
Okay, so we have, let's move on to our road foreman's report. And our road foreman, Lee Chamberlain.
So let's start off with some easy stuff. The park we're lotting plans for the structure are in, if anyone's got a chance to look at them. I guess all clerks need to know is that everything's all set on them. I did look them over and I believe everything's all set. So then they can move forward on it. Canoebrook Apartments, we finished the riprap up there. And then we're just going to be doing some paving up there also. All right. The paving bids, they were put out And we've put those out to Warner Brothers, Vermont Roadworks, Lane, Springfield Paving, and Basin Brothers. We've also been working on cutting some pavement for new culverts on Upper Dummerston Road this last week. And we're going to be working in Carpenter Gravel Pit, starting some reclamation of some of the slopes down there. The Taft Cemetery bids, I thought maybe Steve might want to look at those, but I met with the contractor over there and we talked about cutting the trees, removing the stumps, finish grade and making it into a lawn, and then the total price of the project. Not really knowing how much money either one of them is going to cost. But I thought it would be good to go out to bid, and if we can afford to even cut the trees, it would be a start. So I was just wondering if...
And where does the money come from, Lee, for that?
I was going to invite Terry Chapman the next meeting to talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
She has sold a few plots over to Wilder. There might even be some money left over what was donated for doing land clearing over there.
Okay.
I don't think there's going to be a lot, put it that way. It's more to maybe get started and kind of figure out if we are going to plan on stumping it, how much money we're going to need in the future.
Mm-hmm. Was just the trees, was that what you were thinking? It was about three, is that what you put in?
Yes, that's what I was thinking. The contractor, he thought it could be even less.
Mm-hmm.
But never works out that way.
Right.
So you'll just get some prices and then we'll...
Yeah, we'll go out to bid, we'll have a pre-bid meeting over there, do the whole thing. And I did ask them to fill out this form just so that we can compare them easy at the next meet or when they're due. And that would be just in that order, you know, tree removal, they'd give a price, just dumping it, they'd give another price. And then the total price.
The total price being prepping it for seed and seeding it.
Yeah. Total price, I would say, would even be if they wanted to come in and do the whole thing.
Yeah.
All at once. Because it might be cheaper to go that route rather than just individually do things.
But in a bid, you would have cutting the trees, removing the stumps, and then finish grading. And
we might want to word it something a little bit different than that.
The stumps were going to stay, right? I mean, they're going to be lined
yes.
up in the ditch. Is that what you're, or lined on the perimeter? Is that what you're...
On the north boundary.
Yep.
And if we wanted to remove them in a while, we could, but I think it would add quite a bit of cost to it if we tried to remove them.
We just did a job at Townsend DM, and the stump removal was more than the rest of the project.
Yeah.
Just getting rid of the stumps.
Yeah. It'll be good topsoil in 20 years.
Yeah, we could find a volunteer to take them for 20-year topsoil.
Right, exactly.
Okay.
So in this case, then, like it says, cut all trees over 3 inches, you'd cut everything. I mean, everything would be cleared and cut if they're
yep.
going to give you a proposal for the entire job.
Yep, for that price, they would cut everything over.
Oh, I see. That's just if they're just going to take the trees and not go any further. Okay.
So are you anticipating some people might just bid on one portion?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Or they might, yes, I do think some people would. I was going to even invite people who might only want to bid on... They might give us a good price on the tree removal because that's what they do.
Mm-hmm.
And then they might not have any interest in the rest, or they might have somebody they know will go in with them. I don't know. That's really the only way I can think of it. But,
got it.
Lee, is there any idea of asking them for... about grinding the stumps rather than digging them out?
Yeah, one, he mentioned that. He gave me a couple, names of people.
There are some that do it.
Yeah, he said there was a company that would come right in and grind the whole trees also, make it all mulch, but I don't. Okay, so here we go.
Actually, on the before we get to the paving,
yes,
that's all. That bid's already gone out, or
yes, okay. It's out.
And that was just for 1.1 miles or one.
Yes, the okay. Johnson's Curve, Holton Brook, and Canoebrook.
Okay. I thought Canoebrook looked really good. Did Rick come out and look at what you did when you
yes,
were done?
Yes, yeah, he was happy. Good. Yeah, he was
good.
Happy.
I thought it was right. Really good.
Oh, that's good to know.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't want to.
Oh, no.
I know you're in a hurry to get to the next
no.
item.
No.
And how many places did we bid out the paving to?
Bid? Five, I think
okay,
it was.
Good.
It sounded okay. Like a couple more than last year.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, Warner Brothers and Basin actually called up later and mm-hmm. asked if they could oh. bid on it. You know.
And it was why not? Vermont Roadways?
Roadworks.
That
yeah.
did
last year.
Paving last year.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So, see, told me you didn't want to hear the whole spiel, so. But anyways, we'll start. Most everyone was down at the meeting the other night. So today, we'll start with the, today Steve and I met with Ron Bell. He's an engineer who does these projects. He's the one who did the engineering for the Park Lot and Road project for Clark's.
Lee, do you want
to
change
yeah, do you
places?
Want
to,
do you
why
want
don't
to,
you
no.
sit
it
over?
Oh, whatever.
So you can, yeah.
Yeah, because then you can have a little more eye contact.
Yeah,
sometimes
it's
better.
As in, why is this in the bed?
Yeah, exactly.
Come on.
All
right.
Yes.
All right. Okay. All right. There we go. So we talked with Ron Bell. He ended up giving us a proposal of doing the engineering down there. He sent up a couple photographs of different projects. And he was proposing $7,000 to engineer the project.
Ron Bell is an engineer.
I got that. Why,
okay.
Why do we need an engineer?
No matter what, you have to have an engineer. It's either we've done design builds, and that's where we let the contractors pick their engineer, do the whole project, and then they actually bill us for the engineer work to the contractor. This way here, we hire the engineer. We have to decide on what we would like. That engineer draws it up, goes out to bid, and all the bidders hopefully we'll bid on the same thing, and there will be no question about, you know, this engineer said we had to do this, this engineer said we had to do that.
If you did the job yourself without state money and federal money, would you have to have an engineer?
We haven't had to have an engineer on some of them where
okay.
we did ourselves.
That's what I wanted to know. Okay. Thank you.
Lee, is the engineer's fee covered by the 90%?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So maybe
yes.
90% of 7,000.
Yep. Either way we do it, if we didn't do it this way by hiring an engineer and then him coming up with a plan, we would put it out to bid as we'd tell him what we wanted in a general form, and the contractor would find an engineer and get the plans from them.
If you do a stone bridge, can they engineer that?
Oh yeah, we talked about that because he had to engineer the deck and the railing and.
Yeah, and he did say that one bridge they did was stone.
Right. Yeah, with blue lamb or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The reason I asked because you didn't have an engineer.
Right.
When the south abutment was done, and you just had a very reputable stonemason.
Right. That there we kind of, I don't want to say we knew, but we had a good idea that these people in town were going to work with us.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they're the best, so.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
So our thought for hiring the engineer, in this case, it might help speed up the process because we're starting so late in the construction sequence that if we thought this might help speed up the engineering rather than every contractor hiring or trying to find their own engineer to do the design work.
I was just wondering about the cart and the horse thing. Don't we want to know what we want to do, then choose an engineer to do a project rather than blanketly hiring an engineer? Are we going to have him design different bridges or?
He will design the different options.
Mm-hmm.
So he can, I can't say he could design anything, but I believe he's capable of designing any which way we go.
And he also did the permit, right?
He takes care of all the permits.
Right.
He does not do right of ways. That's an extra. Or I think he will do them, but that's an extra on it. I think it's a good price, what we've paid on design bills for engineering, because we usually pay that once it's done, so that the contractor doesn't have to sit on that money for a long period of time. $7,000 is fairly inexpensive. I believe it was $10,000 to $15,000 last time on the engineering for Quarry Road.
Quarry Road.
So I think that I do believe that's a good price. I think the local contractors, I know Renard's, Clark's, they both use him. So he's likely to be an engineer if we go the other way anyways.
I have more questions, but maybe you want to continue your thing before. Maybe you'll answer my questions before I ask them.
Yep.
And do we want to skip that part of it now, as far as we want to hire?
Let's come back to
okay. That. All right. So I think we can all agree that the hydraulic study said it had to be 16 feet wide, and 5'5" high, in order to get the proper drainage through the structure.
But you were waiting for the AN.
Right, the ANR, but the hydraulic study does tell you the size, and if you went with a 16 foot wide structure, your chances of getting turned down are very slim, because that's what they're going by too. They're going by stream width. So really the proposals I have aren't keeping either abutment. They might be relocating them on the first one, but making it the proper width, proper height, at least, you know, we can't do something that's not, it should be right. So anyways, the first proposal or thought that I had, was remove both bridge abutments. Reconstruct with stone abutments, proper width at 16 feet. With these, they're saying go 6 feet below stream level. This is where it's going to add cost to this side of the project also, if we decide to go this way. We'd have to go 6 feet below stream bed instead of just on the logs that we had put there. So I don't know if Dan or Renard's or whoever would like to do the project. If they would put stone down there, if they'd build up with concrete and then lay stone on top of it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure what they would do. But a wooden deck, and it would have to be, and we all understand that it has to be approved guardrails. No matter if we like them or not. it's that's I know everyone's going to complain about it.
I'm going to do graffiti on it.
Right. And we've heard flower boxes, maybe, or a bush, you know, and that's fine. I think it's, it makes everything look good, you know, and that's what we want. So that's going to bump that price. And these are estimates. And, I have down 180 to 200,000. And that's because they have to, they do have to, it's almost like pouring concrete. They have to go 6 feet below the stream bed, pump the brook, divert the water. It's pretty much the same, same steps.
For anything.
Yeah, yeah. Wood deck, I have down here. I have the wood deck. I think it's going to last 50 years. That's just kind of a, where I would like to see it be a 100-year fix. That's why I'm not totally sold on this proposal, but, all right, so 50 years. And we also need a minimum of 50,000 pounds that it would carry. And that's for fire trucks, town trucks. And wood decks, they always tend to, in its life, it always tends to drop a little bit. Just because they get weaker as age goes.
Does that one need wing walls?
Yes, that'd be wing walls, and I would think they would do it with stone also, you know, the dry laid stone. But the same thing with wing walls, you have to go down the 6 feet. But, all right. So there's that one, all right. This is one that Mike Renard actually came up with. He mentioned it to me, and then I mentioned it to the engineer. And I had never really thought about it. And that's remove the abutments. This would be concrete abutments, but the bridge would be wider, longer, I should say. So the abutments are away from the brook, so it wouldn't need wing walls, because they'd be protected by the soil and the rock.
No, but you shut the abutments back
into the ground, mm-hmm. pretty much. They don't need to be as deep because it's away from the brook. The engineer suggested, and this is just his, we talked with him today, he sent up a list of suggestions. Mm-hmm. So he definitely could think about it more too. But he's saying that it should only have to go down 3 feet below brook bed. So that's dewatering would be a lot less, because you really aren't getting into the brook. You'd be further away from the brook. And that would have a concrete deck and a stamped, and I did talk to Mike about that, a stamped stonework, you know, pattern on the side, however they stamp concrete.
Like they did on 91.
Mm-hmm. Probably. I haven't really looked at that close, but I think that's probably.
Yeah. I think those were painted too, the whole thing. But these are stamped in. Yeah.
I think they were stamped and then they're going to be painted, aren't they?
Yeah.
So when you say these would be stamped in, these are stamped in and look like. How do they look like stone?
They look like stone, yeah, because they lay in a pattern in the form.
Yeah.
When they build their form, they lay a pattern in so you don't just get a straight
right.
concrete, you know, you get the flow that
texture.
Looks like
I'm thinking of the
texture.
Coloration. How do you do
it? Yeah, that? I don't know that it do, I, you know, we didn't talk about coloration.
So you still, it would look like a variegated concrete. It would look like concrete with
yeah.
I would say so, yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Okay. That... Now, and his write-up on that, he did have the slab as, because I was worried about we'd have this 3 foot slab going 24 feet, you know, that, and you would see 23 feet of it or whatever, 22 feet of it. But it would be, what he has written down here is 16 inches deep. That's what the slab would have to be to hold the weight of the vehicles. And then you have a retention sill that holds the gravel on the road. Because as traveling down the road, it would be just gravel, the whole road. You wouldn't go from gravel to concrete to gravel. It would be gravel all the way across. So there'd be a foot of gravel over the cement deck. And so that, I would say the retention sill, what holds the gravel onto the bridge, would be a foot, maybe 8 inches. He doesn't have it in here, but... I wouldn't think it would have to be the full foot. So it'd be, I would say, just, you know, 24 to 28 inches concrete that is stamped that you'd be looking at. That was the one I was leaning towards.
So it'd be 24 to 28 inches, 24 feet.
Well, yeah, I think the gravel's going to slope up. So, yeah, it could be, it could be 20, 20, yeah. You know, I don't, okay.
Lee, can I ask you one thing? I was confused on if the abutments are going to be moved back and you're counting on soil along the stream bank. What's to prevent that soil from eroding in a weather event?
It's actually riprap along the steam.
Oh, it is.
Yeah, against the abutments. Yeah.
So, against the abutments, but then you have a soil to the stream, or is it riprap all the way from the stream to the abutment?
Right. I think there's a
there is a kind of,
and this was only a half hour meeting, right, only 40 minute meeting, but yeah. Basically you would take your riprap back up to the from the stream.
I think you see less concrete in that option.
Right, exactly.
No wing walls, stone there. If we can get soil on some of the riprap, you know, would be great, you know, to kind of, because that, it'd make it look better too. But that's, yeah.
All right, we'll just, do you have a cost?
All right, I'm sorry. Mike actually said a little lower, but I'm just going to say 180 on that. And that is the same reason. It adds cost when you have to go next to the brook, 6 feet below. It just adds cost. And of course, he pours all these slabs down in his yard, down in his shop, too. So, and he has the cranes.
So this is also 16 feet wide, just like the other one?
No, 14.
14.
Oh, this cement is narrower.
14 between the band rails or guardrails or whatever. So it might end up being 16, but your driving lane is 14.
Okay, and this carries 50?
This will be, I believe it's 100,000 is that rating. And that will handle anything in the future. That's what we do, all the structures in town.
If it rates at 100,000, can we put a sign up that says only 30,000 and the fire trucks know they can still come?
Right. Well, the roads are posted for 24.
Yeah. Yeah. So everyone needs an overweight permit anyways.
Right.
And
that hasn't been...
I know. You're always going to get violators, and you're always going to get, you know, it's
so if we see, so if we see
be,
a violator.
There won't be a sign that says, weight limit 100,000.
Right.
Right.
But the truth of it is, if it is 100,000 pounds, someone legitimately can go over it, even if you have a sign that says, you know.
But he said the roads are posted, so if we see somebody that's really heavy, we can take the license plate and turn them in.
Right.
Because of the roads, right. Not the bridge.
Right, if they don't have an overweight permit.
Right.
How do we know who has overweight permits?
Call the town office.
Tell
them. Yeah, I was going to say that. They have them on record.
Yeah, she covers herself.
She's on speed dial.
Yeah, I thought so.
Now, the third option was just the rigid frame bridge. And... that would be the 16 feet wide, 6 feet below stream bed, 4 foot wing walls on each end. I believe it would be more concrete showing. And that's why I didn't go with that option. I do have a couple pictures up here, and we tried to diagrams that he had sent up and to show how much concrete was going to be showing. So, I think I'm coming to my end.
Oh, Lee, can I ask you one question that's just a little confusing? When you're talking about the 16 feet, are you always referring to the width of the bridge, or sometimes you're referring to the span underneath, right?
The hydraulic study will actually, yes, the 16 feet is what they need for width for the actual brook width.
Right, so I think that's...
Brook width.
The width of the brook, which
yes,
is the
I'm
length
sorry,
of the bridge.
If I got that.
Okay,
I'm sorry
so
if I got that.
So how do they have width, like, the cars are going on?
Yeah, now that's 14 feet between
okay.
the band rails, or between the
okay.
guardrails.
So none of these are duplicating what we have, in essence, really?
The closest one would be option one. You'd have stone with wood deck. You're still going to have the same guardrails as probably in all three options are more than likely. We're going to do as much research as we can, but it more than likely it's going to be the same guardrail on each bridge.
Mm-hmm.
And option one, it takes care of the hydraulics of the brook
mm-hmm.
for the future floods.
And the guardrail on the bridge, we have the option of choosing whether it's shiny galvanized or rusty metal.
I know. I heard today that the rust might be back in, but I'm not sure yet. We have to do some options. For example, the guardrail that we had talked about the last meeting, it went from, this is just one person telling us a price, but $35 a foot for regular guardrail that's out on the road. $200 a foot for that guardrail. Yeah, that new that box beam guardrail that I showed you.
Really?
Yeah.
$35 a foot for the W or for whatever you call it.
Yeah.
You call that a box beam?
Yeah,
I thought it was just a metal thing.
It's a box beam.
So it, you know, everything's got to be weighed in.
Part of that was at the meeting, Mark from the Department of Transportation, he said that, you know, they price for a standard guardrail. They're not going to price for the, you know, we're not going to get 90% of a $200 a foot, or
he
unless
says,
the Historic Society of
exactly.
Vermont came in and said,
yeah.
you know, this has value, so we're going to pay it. So
the stamping, mm-hmm. oh, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. That's it.
The stamping, for the one contractor's no extra cost, you know, as far as, Mark did mention about the historic, if it comes in as historic, and, they might be willing to do something with a facing on the bridge, stone facing. But if it's not historic, then, you know, they can't really pay for that. He did mention that, but.
We also talked about a wood facing at one time too. And you were going to go back and talk to Renault about, you were going to go back and talk to Renault about a different option. So you have talked to Renault since we've met?
Yes.
Okay.
I believe so.
You believe so?
No. I'm pretty sure. I talked to about 100 people.
When was the last time you met?
I just want to make sure I'm taking accurate notes here. The first option, you said the cost would be $180,000 to $200,000?
I believe so.
The second is about $180,000?
Yes.
Approximately. Did you mention a price for the third?
I was told figure on around $200,000.
Okay.
No matter what option we say we want, the middle option at $180,000, what we think it's $180,000, and the price I got is around $180,000. The state actually puts it into their fund as higher than that, just to make sure it covers everything.
Okay.
And then we only pay, if it comes in at $120,000, we only have to pay the $12,000.
Mm-hmm.
But they just, if they put in for $200,000 and it comes in at $250,000, it's a lot harder to get that $50,000.
Mm-hmm.
It's better to put it in high and then just not use it all.
So when we first spoke, I know this was
earlier
on, but you told me the first option was half the price of the third option. So it looks like the price doubled.
Yeah, and that's...
Is that because of the depth?
Yes, the stream
okay.
bed,
right.
getting scour protection underneath the stone.
I think the first time you went to Jared, it was just... We were just talking about one abutment.
Yeah, and redoing that one abutment and pretty much doing it just the way we did the south abutment, not putting any scour protection under it.
And what was that? Did you have a price on that?
Yeah, I think that was like, well, I was thinking around half, so 80, 100, 125.
To do one abutment.
Well, one abutment and a new bridge deck.
And that still wouldn't meet the 16-foot.
Right, that
would not meet the hydraulics.
That would only be the 7 feet wide.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. Finish up.
Well, one thought or concern is that, as you know, this bridge, this wooden bridge, has a basically a 9.5 foot travelway because of the tracks that are on the bridge. And so with a new proposal, whether it's A, B, or C, with A, you might be able to deal with it, but B and C, you've got a 14-foot wide travel lane, and when you look, it'll look just like the road. It won't look like you're going over a bridge. There won't be a bridge factor. There'll be, as I envision,
right,
from
exactly,
what you're saying,
exactly.
There would be bandrail on the sides.
The flower boxes.
Yeah.
I like the flower boxes.
Yeah. Yeah. We know who can provide them.
The flowers.
So you'd have a band rail on the sides, and a 14 foot road that starts from Middle Road and continues up Tucker Reed Road. And historically, this wooden bridge has served as a kind of a calming influence, and it definitely has. So people don't come off Middle Road at 20 miles an hour or 15 miles an hour and accelerate from the moment that they get onto Tucker Reed. They slow down at the bridge, and then they accelerate. This would be kind of a big turn. Hit the accelerator and go, which I think would, you know, I know if I were living in the Johnson Lyons or the Reed's house, I would be very concerned about that. And, you know, it's bad enough when they get to the top of the hill, but this has been kind of a, and Mark said the other day, you shouldn't use the bridge as a traffic calming mechanism.
But it is.
But in fact, it has been. And when you take that away, it does affect the character and the feeling of the area. And so you don't see a bridge, you just see a dirt road from coming off Middle Road. And so those are my points and concerns. And I think the impact would be, so my preference, I guess, while I'm here, I might as well say my preference is to go with option A, your first option. And I understand your point, but I think if you do that, you are helping to keep the property values without from depreciating, from having negative influences on them. So it also helps. Jack once mentioned that last week that he, you know, his customers also like to have a little ambiance, a little Vermont flavor when they come up to his farm at Elysian Hills, and this is all part of the experience. And I think if we can maintain that experience somehow, it's good for Jack, good for the neighbors, and therefore good for the town.
The bridge does have to be made wider.
I'm sorry?
The bridge, Mark Pickering did say the bridge would have to be wider. If we replaced the wood deck, it would have to be wider.
Right.
Yeah, but
we were talking 14, I'm sorry. Jack.
No, go ahead.
I thought we were talking 14 feet.
Wider than it is now.
Yeah, but it's 12.6 or something now, you said. Somebody said.
Right.
Yeah, and Lee
it was the first option. Maybe I wrote down. I thought the first option was 16 feet wide, and the second option was 14 feet wide.
Oh, see, that's where we got confused again there.
It's a different wide.
Yeah, the brook width is 16 on the first option.
In other words,
the
span.
Right,
and it's still 14 feet between.
Okay, so the width of the bridge is always 14 feet.
Yes, between the band rails.
But I don't know, the length of the bridge then.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got 60. Bridge length, stream width, width.
Yeah.
Define the terms.
Yep.
I wanted to say, he's nodding at me because I've got my hand up. I wanted to say, when Lee was talking about number one, we had talked about, with Jared, we had talked about going back further for him to put the wall in. And then I think the last comment you made that it would only be that 16 feet long. But I think we had talked about going back when we were at the bridge.
Right now, it is 7 feet between the two abutments. And so we can't really take the north abutment and move it 9 feet to make it the 16. Because then you still have the hydraulics pushing on the south abutment. So to do it right, you have to take out both abutments, go evenly or center it up on the brook the best that it can be, and then do it that way. I don't know if that answered that.
Yeah, I think it does. All right. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay.
I know when we were at the meeting, Mark had said that they don't like to funnel the guardrails into the bridge. But I found that in traveling around in a number of intersections and roundabouts, Florida does this, they use that as traffic calming. You know, if you have a gravel bridge that's 14 feet wide and it's just part of the road, I think people are going to fly down that hill and fly up it. And it's, of course, a concern to us also because we're running tractors up there. And although it may not be as bad as Route 5, it's still the visibility, you know, when we're coming up a hill and something could be bad. So, of course, we're concerned. And I think that's always one of the main issues in town is speed on back roads. You know, everybody wants to keep the speeds down. And everybody wants to keep the rural aspect of the neighborhood, generally, because that's why they live here. But I think with... maybe it would be worthwhile to explore more with the Agency of Transportation what they might have for traffic calming going across those bridges, you know, so that it doesn't look like a straight zoom right across, you know, that there, because, you know, those Chappaquiddick side rails and the planks in the middle, they were traffic calming, you know? And so I think we'll be, you know, and it's no offense, Paul, time for that bridge has passed, you know, that kind of bridge, but still, the option A, I think, is adequate to meet both the structural concerns that we might have for a long-lasting bridge and also, you know, the rural aspects that we might like to see. But I think still we need a little further work maybe in trying to slowly approach
that. Yeah, I wonder if there can be some way of maybe widening the road before you get to it, so it appears smaller.
No, it's widened enough as it is.
Put the guardrails, those blocks, you know, so it gives the appearance of narrowing down.
Really wide window box.
Right. Yes.
That we could do.
But maybe start the guardrails before you get actually on the bridge so they...
Well, then you end up with guardrails in front of the driveway.
I want to go that far.
I came up with 14 feet, just figuring, you know, our snow plows are 9 foot cuts. The greater blade straight across is 12. Not that you should have it straight across when it goes across the bridge, but it gives a little bit of room for error. And that's how the 14, and measuring the road up each side, it was 14. You know, a little bit flared out on the ends, the guardrails, you know, that will definitely give it a little bit of a look.
Lee, what's the travel width of the covered bridge?
I would... the travel width for the new runners, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
I think it's like 16 in there though. If you, I think it is 16. Maybe. Yeah, I almost think it. I don't know. I'd have to. I don't know. I do know that two cars used to be able to pass in there before
you had the bumpers.
But
they're still trying.
Yeah. No, I'm not sure.
And that's what concerns me too. The people that come up to the Christmas tree place, a lot of them aren't familiar, and a lot of them don't wait for another car. They just come right by. They don't stop and wait, you know. And I'm assuming that a lot of locals do the same thing, but I notice it a lot in the October through December bit. They just come down off the hill, and they don't care that you're coming up. So I think, from my perspective, this has been great with the bridge closed. I mean, it's unbelievable. Yeah. I stopped and talked to Jack and Karen coming up the other day. It's quiet. There's no noise. You know, I only saw Jack that one day and the whole going up and down.
They do have signs, you know, as you see on different bridges, you know, where the bridge is narrower than a road. You know, the chevron's pointing people towards the center. But
we could make it one way.
Yeah, that's an option.
No, that's not a good option. You got to remember, that's a class 3 road,
know,
that the town receives state aid for.
Yeah.
And it's not a private driveway. No. You know, so much as I know you guys would like to live on a quieter road, you know that's a class 3 road.
Yeah.
It's been a class 3 road for a long time, so you're not moving into anything new.
I think it was a class 3 when we moved there, and it was half the
way. Well, when you guys lived there, it was horse and buggy.
Not quite.
And that's
not quite. 47 years.
Yeah. Yeah. That's why I go with B, because it is a class 3 road. We're on a 100-year cycle for all our structures, park lot and road. We would never put something up there that's going to last 50 years. We wouldn't, or I'd hope we wouldn't, because we can't afford in 50 years. We're passing the buck, because we're making somebody in 50 years come up with money that the town isn't going to have, unless the state's going to come up with more money, which, you know, that's not happening. We get funding every 2 to 3 years. And with 43 of these things, it has to be, I just strongly believe it has to be the best looking, or the best what we can do, what's going to last us 100 years.
43 bridges?
Yes. Or 43 that we
structures.
Need structures, what we need hydraulic studies for. And there's, if we get one under 100,000, I'll be some surprised.
Yeah, I guess I appreciate it. I'd like to kind of echo that a little bit. I mean, we've heard a lot about the traffic, you know, coming in, but, you know, that bridge starts, what, 40 yards off Middle Road, you know, and then it goes for another 20 yards.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're talking about, and you've all said it, you know, they're going to turn off Middle Road. When they make that turn, they're going what I would hope would be a reasonable speed. And so you got 40 yards before they get on the bridge, 20 yards are off the bridge, and then everybody has said here, they just accelerate up the road. So, I mean, just the discussion to me doesn't appear like that the bridge, if we're talking, you know, maybe doing a 50 by 100 year bridge to save speed for 20 yards. Because they're not accelerating before they get to the bridge. They're going across the bridge slowly, and then they're accelerating. So
they are now going across the bridge slowly because of the way the structure.
Okay,
of the
that's what I'm saying. They're coming off Middle Road at a normal speed. They're slowing down for 20 yards, and then they're accelerating. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about an expense for, and now how many times a day this happens, I don't know, 20 yards of slowing somebody down. I guess in my mind right now, I mean, I understand where you're coming from and why you're bringing it up, but that doesn't seem to be like, I guess the bang we're getting for putting a bridge in that could potentially have to be replaced sooner than another one for a very small period of trying to slow somebody down. You know, it's risk versus gain, it's expense versus benefit. I just don't, I'm not seeing it.
But don't forget, that's just part of the equation.
Yeah.
That the, you know, the beauty of the stonework or the rural characteristic mm-hmm. of the bridge is also a factor to mm-hmm. be weighed. And I also like to point out that I'm not positive about those estimates about the durability and the length mm-hmm. of time of those bridges, because that I-91 bridge is not 100 years old,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I bet when they built it, they said it would be before it needed to be replaced, you know, so cement deteriorates, and I think sometimes can deteriorate faster than wood
in
certain instances.
With salt, I don't question that, but we don't use salt in the sand, and that's why we...
You don't?
No. No, we stop using salt in the sand. The only time we use salt on the dirt is if in the real, there's like once a year when certain roads will get ice spots, and we might just put a little on, just to help the sand stick. But Tucker Reed Road isn't one that gets you know, ice buildup. It's usually the real high traffic gravel roads. But no, we stop using salt and sand. We just deal with it.
Well, I agree with Jack because I think, you know, when we were talking about the covered bridge a long time ago, and engineers started to realize that wood has a lot more life than they thought they had from the old time engineers. So, yeah, I would kind of doubt those timelines too. But
yeah, I'm not an engineer, but I would also suspect, you know, just like, you know, I know there's a difference between cement and concrete, yeah. And probably some guy expert will, you know, get on me, but I think we've probably been, you know, they've got better material now. They've, you know, better way of mixing it, pouring it, doing that. But I also suspect when they put the Eisenhower Highway system in here in the 60s, they couldn't have envisioned the amount of traffic that was going to cross that bridge. Mm-hmm. You know, I think you're talking about the one probably over Upper Dummerston Road. That's the concrete bridge, right, that you're talking about. Yeah. I mean, I just think the use of, and, you know, it's kind of going down a rabbit hole that I don't need to, but I mean, I think the use of that probably is, they never could have anticipated, you know, the amount of traffic that comes into Vermont by opening up the state with those. So, I mean, I just say, I understand what you're saying, you know, that one didn't last as long as they thought, but I probably a lot of projections went into that as well.
And I just wonder if the projections for the wood bridge are automobiles only, basically, and not very much truck traffic at all. I mean, our deliveries, I'm not sure which way you come in, Steve, but...
Yeah, we come in the north side.
Yeah, Chris, we come in the north side, so the durability of the bridge is probably not accurate because they're measuring it against potential weight that truck traffic may have going across it, and other than the grader and town trucks, I don't know any other trucks that really go across there.
Are you thinking a 50-year wood bridge?
Yeah.
Thinking
yeah.
What durability
yeah, so I don't, yeah, so I think... And, you know, in that case, like, you could argue that the cement bridge might also last longer.
Yeah.
But, you know, so I think there's a lot of factors there that don't quite add up to the maybe.
Sure.
Yeah, it has been posted for 8 tons of 16,000,
right.
So you wouldn't get a very big vehicle. Mm-hmm. I mean, really, an oil truck shouldn't even be going over it. But yeah.
The present deck, and Wayne can probably verify this, but I think was put on in 2002. That's what my notes indicated, and so that's 14 years, and it's still in very, very good shape, the deck itself. So in terms of the wood lasting and that kind of thing, that's one factor to bear in mind. The other factor I'd like you to consider is that the potential negative effect of the an alternative bridge, you know, that would have on property values. Now that's an unknown, but it's a real possibility in the sense of you've got two very valuable properties right at the entrance of that bridge. And if those properties were to depreciate by 10 or 15% because of the nature of the traffic or the speed of the traffic or what have you, that's an impact on the town financially. You know, so you talk about financially in terms of maintenance. And so this is a countervailing, perhaps a countervailing argument. So, you know, I just throw that out there for your consideration, too.
I guess I'd just like to add to that. I agree with everything that was said, and I think that since the decision is hinging on the extra 50 years, it makes a great deal of sense to make sure that those are accurate numbers before we make the decision. Perhaps there's a way of doing that.
Get a wood engineer.
Well, whatever. It must be people.
Anyway, so I know you guys have a tough decision to make.
Yes, we do.
Well, I would hope that the only decision isn't on the 50-year piece, but considering the aesthetics and the setting in which it's being placed as well. So I know that you have a fiduciary responsibility to make the best decision possible, but that doesn't necessarily mean the most modern.
Mm-hmm. And that's the only laid-up stone bridge left in town. That's it.
Right. You know, when I go over it. I don't see the stone. I see the wood deck, of course. But we're lucky that you noticed that the abutment had failed, because you simply don't see the stone when you go over.
Well, it was
you do if you walk.
It was an early morning walk.
Yeah.
So that was fortunate.
Yeah.
So, and there had been a car. There were two cars. One had come up the hill, and one had gone down the hill prior to my getting to the bridge.
And I saw John Brunel going down the hill. So,
but anyway, it's.
May I ask, is this decision being made this evening?
It could be.
Even though we don't have all the information, I understand the state was supposed to come in and look at this.
We could make a decision and have it subject to the state approving, you know, getting the Agency of Natural Resources and the historic. So we could tentatively make a decision subject to, you know, approval from the state.
But wouldn't they approve any of these proposals as long as they had the width and the height?
No, I don't.
And the guardrails.
Yeah, and the guardrails. Thanks, Jim.
It's a good possibility, I believe.
Well, I have not said much here because I felt this was a sort of phase two of gathering information from Lee and all of you, and also hearing from my neighbors. But we, Jim and I, are the ones who are most impacted by this bridge. And truthfully, this is like my worst nightmare, having this bridge go away. For the safety issue, most of the fast traffic, the people who come down that hill are accelerating, partly because they're coming down the hill, also because many of them don't know that what's ahead is that bridge, which is a one-lane bridge now. And very noticeably a one-lane bridge because of the wooden planks. If you widen it and take away those planks, particularly in the evening, for people who don't know that road, I really feel it's an accident waiting to happen, because many people will think it is a two-lane road and they can fit through. And cars and trucks, and I'm talking about the box trucks, delivery trucks, you know, like the FedEx, UPS people, rip down that road at a speed. There are evenings when we're having dinner when I'm watching them and hearing them and thinking, this is it. This is the one that's going to go over the bridge. So I would just caution you that whatever you do, you may not use the bridge as a calming factor, but it will create the illusion that it's a two-way road there. So I just want to point that out, because we are oriented to the back of our home. We do not live in the front of the home. We live in the back of our home. We look at that bridge from all our windows. So we see the speed at which people do come down that way. And it is frightening, not all the time, but enough times that we're sort of holding our breath. The other thing I want to point out is that one of the reasons we left Brattleboro to come to desirable Dummerston was that we were intrigued and by the charm, by the historic nature, by the large tracts of land, by the fact that people put their land in trust and have land use programs. And so that reputation that Dummerston has is really, I think, oh, there's a microcosm of it right at that intersection where you go up to Elysian Hills, where you go up to paradise, literally. So although that's an intangible, and as Jim Reed said, you have a fiduciary responsibility, I would just like to say that is part of what people love about Dummerston and what draws them here, whether they're out-of-towners or people who are locals. And that's an important part of what makes it Dummerston. I like the idea that we all share that, we're like-minded about that. So I do hope you'll take all of this into consideration. I know it's just a small bridge, but it represents a lot of who we are and what a lot of people have worked very hard over the years to preserve about this town. So thank you for listening, and I do appreciate Lee's coming up with a second option here. Although I would much prefer the first.
Wayne Emery, could I put you on the spot?
You can try.
Just curious,
Do you have any thoughts?
I got a lot of thoughts, but I don't know if I want to voice them. No, it's, I think it's time to do something with it. We definitely have to, but I really would like to see the second option myself, because I think that it's, the lifespan of a wooden structure is not there compared to the concrete if it's done right. And I know I've heard talk about the bridges on 91, but I helped build that in the state, and I can tell you a lot of that concrete work that was done back in the 50s and 60s, it wouldn't be done the same today. If you remember the William Street Bridge, if you're driving by there, you'd see great big chunks of concrete that fell off from the piers. And the reason it did is because of the rebar that they used wasn't coated, and the moisture got to it, and it just popped, it freeze up in the wintertime, and it popped that concrete right off. And they didn't have concrete enough away from the rebar. So, and that's what's happened to a lot of these bridges up and down the interstate. And they're going to have to replace pretty near every one of them over the years. But I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I did put that deck on that bridge in 2002. But I'm surprised that the deck stood up that long, because usually the wooden decks don't last more than 7 or 8 years.
Yeah, it was the first pressure-treated deck on it.
Yeah. Also, you took good care of it. You kept it clean.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which we thank you for.
The last ones were all hemlock before that, the decks.
Yeah. Right. Those didn't last only about 3 years.
Yeah.
3 or 4. So, what's your pleasure here?
Well, we really got two issues. We got, number one, we need to probably figure out what we're going to do about the engineer, if we're going to hire him, or, and then the second one is how we proceed on our bridge decision, so.
Okay. How about a motion to hire Ron Bell?
I would move that we hire an engineer, or hire Ron Bell to engineer this, so that whatever goes out to bid, everybody's bidding the same project.
Yeah,
I think it would help just speed up the process so that we're not doing this in October, November.
So is that a motion?
That was a motion.
All right. I second the motion.
Okay. Any discussion?
No, and I'll just put it on there. I think that that's probably the way to go. When I first got on here a few months ago, I think this is probably something we should do with almost every project that we do that requires engineering. Is that way when the bids go out, the guys who are bidding on it, they're all coming off the same sheet. They're all looking at the same thing, the same specs. They're not doing the engineering on their own. So I think this is a step in the right direction.
And is Ron Bell someone that we've worked with before?
Ron's done a lot of the engineering for, like, Wynn Clark, the work that Wynn's done. He was meeting in Springfield on a bridge this morning before he met with Lee. He does a lot of Mike Renard's engineering, so it's, he's done a lot of bridge work. I think he's doing one out in Guilford, he told us too, right? Or he just finished.
So.
Yeah. Yeah, Ron does a lot of bridge.
Okay, any more discussion? All right, a motion and second to hire Ron Bell as the engineer for this project. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. So, all right, and moving on.
Can I just ask Lee?
Sure.
Is there more information that you think you can gather, or are we waiting? I know some of this stuff, Mark said if we submitted it, then we'd get an answer to what we submitted if it didn't meet
right.
spec. But is there more information that you think we need to gather prior to trying to make a decision?
I do think Wayne addressed the concrete issues of the interstate versus Tucker Reed Road as far as concrete. Even on the bridges down here, we had to close up the weep holes because they didn't want the salt running down off the bridge. They'd rather have it run across the bridge. So I think that's addressed, but I am not sure on the, like when Jack said, you know, what the wood deck, and of course if it's engineered for Mike talked about glue lam beams for runners. You know, I don't know what they do put on the surface, and if they put, I don't even know if there's glue lams been out there for 50 years, so all glue lam could fall, you know, what's been out in the weather. I don't know if there's any real information about, you know, if, because I was figuring, you know, pressure treated, I've always heard 40 years. That's just what I've heard. You know, I don't think that's a bad number, but could it last longer? It could. Could concrete last longer if no salt gets to it? I definitely believe that.
One thing I'd just like to mention, when they did that bridge in the 60s, at the time, they felt that that was the best method possible.
Yes.
So,
yes.
The only way we're going to know
right.
if this is the best method possible.
We're never going to know.
I think Steve will still be around in 100 years, but a lot of us won't be. You know? And so, you know, it's always, you know, debatable whether it's...
Yeah. So as far as more information, unless somebody has something that maybe I should get, all right.
All right, he says. Well, I just wanted to know, Lee, Mike Renault has been really good about bridges.
Yep.
Really creative about things for the town of Dummerston.
Yep.
And I wonder if he might really come up with something that would work for all of us. Because he has been super that way.
Yeah, he did come up with the idea of moving the footings back where I wasn't thinking of that at all, and alleviating a lot of the concrete on the ends by doing that.
I wondered if that was an excuse. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, no, I didn't ask about, and I don't know, you asked too, about concrete footings and wood deck. You know, where the price would be.
Yeah.
That is, you know, kind of a combination, which, you know, I don't know if that's helpful or not, you know, but I did not get that combination.
I'd like to hear from him on some of this. I mean, really put his head to it.
Yeah.
What are we losing by if we wait? You know, I mean, there's a lot of discussion here. You know, it's sometimes it's nice to think about things after you have a discussion for a while. I mean, what are we losing, or what will be lost if this we don't decide this for till the next select board meeting? I mean, are we getting too far down the road for?
I'd like to not wait that long. If we don't decide tonight, I think we should have a special meeting early next week, because the problem is we're going to get into the construction season and find out that.
Right,
we're
going to
miss this year. It'll be really late this year.
Jared was already booked up.
Right.
That could be the problem if we wait too long.
He said that could be Jared said that it could be a question whether if it was this year. Not that it couldn't be, but he did say, does the price matter on if it's this year or next spring, you know?
Jack wants it this year, and I can understand why Jack wants it.
So not that he couldn't do it. I'm just saying that it... and all these are just, you know, estimates on the prices too.
Yeah, nothing's gone out to bid.
Right, nothing's gone out to bid, and we really can't go out to bid until, because the engineer really can't do anything, we don't have any money, I believe, to pay the engineer, because we aren't even going to know if the project's going forward until we pick an idea. So I think it is pretty crucial that we pick an idea, or because the state's going to take a while, then the engineering's going to take another month, just say, and then you got to put it out to bid for another month, you know, and hopefully that's a little shorter each one, but you know, you end up and you have to be out of the water by, I think it's October 1st or even maybe September 15th, somewhere in there, but.
And Mike did. I'm sorry.
Oh, would it make a difference to you
with your business, whether it was this year or next?
Sure. It definitely would make a big difference. Okay. And I think it would also make a difference to the you know, the community that use that road. I know I have two people that stay at the farm, caretake the farm, and then there's the Schmitz, and then there's also, you know, the Brunells, the Goldsmiths, and
sure.
I don't know the other gentleman's name on the corner there, but that probably use that road. But I mean, I think to have a, you know, to have I-91 bridge closed down for 3 years makes that all the difference. So I think this makes a minor difference. It, yeah, I'd like to see it, you know, ideally, and I was very encouraged by the state. I thought they were, they bent over backwards to put this on the fast track. And, yeah, I don't think, I know you'd like to last forever on a dead-end road, but I think it's important to get it done, you know, fairly rapidly from my point of view.
Right, because option B might be the quicker option than option A.
Right. And the fallback to Jody with ideas from Mike and things. Mike was actually the one that came up with the idea of stamping the concrete so it would, wouldn't look like a just a straight wall. He was the one that came up with the idea of setting our abutments a little further back so you don't have to have the wing walls. So I think in Lee's discussions with people, we're getting some
good
ideas.
Did Mike ever talk about a wooden deck in
combination? I don't think, I don't know.
Not in combination with the...
Because you could set it right on
concrete.
But would we go back to wing walls would be my question if we considered that.
Right. The longer you go with the wood bridge, the, of course, the thicker the
What would the length of that one be with the abutments pulled back, Lee?
He has down 24, I believe.
Yeah.
24-foot slab.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah,
so
that's what he has. And like I say, you know, I don't want to, like, hold him to this. I mean, he had, like, an hour to work on it before.
Yeah, this wasn't a big
yeah, and this was,
stuff.
He was doing it as a freebie to kind of get us some information for the meeting. So I don't want to, you know.
Because that would be an interesting compromise if you could do the abutments and just spread the abutments and have a wooden deck with wood, with wouldn't travel, you know, travel things. That would create a little bit more of a feeling of Vermont, and it also would do something in terms of the traffic situation that we're all concerned about. I know you guys get complaints about speeding traffic
everywhere.
So if you could have one less road to have to deal with that, it would be nice.
Yeah, you do have the maintenance over of
right.
upkeep on the runners. But.
And he did mention today when we mentioned wood, he did say the state, and I know they frowned he did say that the state frowned on wood decks. Not that he didn't say that they could put one in, but he did make that comment. Just, this is Ron. And if I heard him right, that's what he said. I'm pretty sure.
Mark seems to indicate that wouldn't be an issue.
Right, right. And so it definitely would need, that would be one of the things to check on if we're going to check on.
How about, do you want to wait, either we have a special meeting next week sometime, we collect some more information in the meantime, or do you want to go ahead and take a vote tonight on a decision?
Hugh, you probably couldn't make it like on a Monday, right?
I look my calendar.
What would work for you?
Let me get my. What is today?
Today is
the
25th.
Yes.
23rd. I could make. Well, Memorial Day is Tuesday.
Oh, my. That's right. Memorial Day is Monday.
I mean, I could make it Tuesday, and I would have to check on Wednesday next week.
The other thing is with Ron is he was leaving in about a month, right?
Yeah, I thought it was like, the 23rd or something, June or somewhere
so
in there.
Wanna...
And your schedule for next week?
I'm here.
Okay.
So I have two questions, though.
One, just
okay.
One more schedule. We wouldn't have to meet you know, it's six, or we could be models of flexibility as far as the time, right?
Mm-hmm. By Monday or Tuesday.
Or whatever, whenever we could get.
What day is Memorial Day?
Monday.
Jeez, all right.
It's always
Monday. Can you give me?
So it'd have to be Tuesday.
Yeah. Okay, your question.
So two questions. I didn't get a sense from people, one of the differences between option one and option two was, with option two, the abutments are much farther apart. Is that an issue for people, or isn't that a big deal?
Do you mean across from one side of
the
brook to the other side of the brook?
Right.
The width.
The width of the abutments.
Where the water is flowing. Yeah.
Right, so option one, they're here. Option two, they're here.
Mm-hmm.
Is that an issue for people?
I don't think that was. I think the concrete was the issue.
It's concrete wood.
The 2 foot concrete sidewalls.
Yeah.
There was less wing wall, if I remember
on
what you're saying, with the apartments pulled back, and so that would be
no wing wall.
No wing wall. So that makes it more attractive.
Exactly. Okay.
Or less unattractive.
Get your story straight.
Yeah.
So then the other question is, if we make a choice tonight, as you said, Lee, Mike came and, you know, within 45 minutes or so gave you some ideas so that we could move forward with this. If we chose one or the other, is it likely to evolve or change, or, you know, once you get an engineer in there the actual design in the end?
I do believe they're going to be close.
Uh-huh.
I do. I mean, the of course, concrete is, I think it would be pretty much exact.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know, they make precast cement bridges.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can get them pretty much.
Okay.
However, the stone, you know, the price might.
I'm not talking about the price. I'm talking about the design. So, you know, I just didn't know how. You said, well, we wouldn't want to hold Mike to that dimension, but, you know, he was only there for 45 minutes. So I was just, you know, I don't want to create an expectation that, well, we chose this, and so then why are we doing this? Because there's, you know, things that happen in between, and things change, and for reasons. So I just didn't know how likely it was to be what we're actually talking about here tonight.
Stay put.
When the engineer looked at the project, I mean, he looked at the site. He did his best.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Ledge. You know, all those unknowns.
Right.
Width of material on each side of the footing where it would go, you know, as far as if there's enough material there to actually cover the footing,
mm-hmm.
or the abutment.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he knew what we were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't really say anything different.
Okay.
You know, like, no, that's...
Yeah,
no,
I just didn't have a sense of how many unknowns there are.
Yeah, there's probably more than we'd all like to know, but there's always...
I know
always
a lot more about old houses than I know about bridges and abutments.
And it hasn't been engineered. It has, you know, he hasn't done his diligence.
Right, exactly, exactly. So that's why I'm asking.
Yeah, I think it's close.
I have another question, though, and
all right.
It may be foolish, but if you put the concrete deck on, can you put a wooden deck on top of it?
Right. I'd be more inclined to put a wood plate along the side of it.
But
I don't know.
Thinking
I don't know of
the tracks to make it look like a single lane bridge.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
But you'd have your concrete underneath.
Right.
And then if you had to replace the wood, you just pick up the wood and put some more wood down on top of the concrete.
He could. But you know,
I'm sorry.
It's not a. It's not a. You know, I just got me thinking, but it. You kind of got a little bit of a point. You know, he might be able to form, I can't believe I'm saying this, but he might be able to form actual wheel tracks in the bridge.
Yeah.
you know, when he, because he does everything right in his yard.
Oh. Well, that
and then you could put the planks in those wheel tracks, you know what I mean, if you left that out. But I'm not saying that that's
so you'd have gravel form and then wood, so you still have gravel.
Oh. But
You still got gravel.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, unless you left the cement showing. If you left the cement higher, you might be able to do something like that. I've never seen it done, never heard of it done, but...
Yeah, it'd get dirty over time.
Yeah, the goal was to keep the gravel deep enough so you could grade it.
Yes. Yeah, I lost my thought there.
I mean, that sounded like a good idea, but then you got the idea of fixing that with a plow or something, too.
Well, you might come up with something if you push him a little bit.
You know, last Friday night, we were given two options, and it was A and C, and in the last couple of days, we've come up with, Leah's come up with option B. It makes one wonder, you know, since Friday night, I mean, is there another option that we just haven't thought of? And so I appreciate, you know, what Hugh said about sometimes you come away from a meeting and things start to percolate and you are focused on problem solving in a way that has benefits. This bridge is going to be around for a long time. Usually decisions that you have to live with for many decades, you allow a little bit more time to come up with solutions that are more creative and perhaps more beneficial to everybody concerned. Not just the neighbors.
So what's the sense here? My sense is that we're willing to collect some more information, look at some different options, more options, and meet back at some point next week and take another look at it. Is that what are you?
Yeah, I think if we meet early in the week, I'm just concerned about timelines, but I think it wouldn't hurt to mull over the ideas. I don't know if Lee would want to have even time to follow up with anybody else.
Yes, that would be tough.
I don't mind asking Mike, but Bernard, about the wood deck and what size he might think it has to be to expand. Mm-hmm. It's going to have to span if you want to. If you want to hide the abutment as much as possible,
be longer,
mm-hmm. I would say, just what I think. But so you're talking bigger beams,
mm-hmm.
Higher deck, you know, that kind of thing to accommodate the weight.
Using steel stringers rather than wood stringers.
Right, a steel bridge with wood, steel stringers with wood deck.
Well, that's interesting, too.
That's an idea.
I mean, the other thing that really strikes me is the whole thing of it being a one-lane bridge and what makes it look like a one-lane bridge at dusk coming down a hill that you're not familiar with. I mean, that, you know, I mean, I don't know how to do that, but it's definitely something to... Is it obvious, you know?
Right this second... As far as how it looks now and
why it looks like... As you picture options one and two, is it obvious that it's a one-lane bridge?
When I look at, and I think 14 feet and people don't want to bang their cars up, so they hopefully will stay a foot away from the band rail. So that makes it 12.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's obvious.
Okay.
Just like when we plow snow, our plows are 10.
Mm-hmm.
They cut 9, but they're 10 feet wide.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't want to bump the band rail because it's expensive.
Mm-hmm.
And so you got 2 feet or, you know what I mean? You got to have a little bit of room there.
Mm-hmm.
Could you go to 13 and make it? Maybe, you know?
Couldn't you put a $10 sign on either side?
Right.
Well,
I mean,
I wondered if there were any signs now. Right. No.
But you know what helps are the trees on the side of it too, to make it look smaller.
But,
and it depends on how much of that you have to cut out.
Well, I'd throw out my last thing on this. So I think, you know, we've got a lot of road experience here. You know, we got years and years, Wayne talked, you know, we've got what you said, we got Lee. You know, we've the feelings, you know, the talking about the aesthetics of the community, I get it. You know, the longevity of it's important to me as well. You know, now
not sure whether I'll be here or not, but certainly not if it's a concrete one, right?
Like
my kids will, you know, what do they say? The key to flexibility is indecision, but let's not be too flexible. But I certainly wouldn't mind, and I don't want to reinvent the wheel, go out and get something maybe entirely new, but just if, in my own personal sense, I wouldn't mind just balancing these things in my own mind for a couple of days. You know, whether I go with the concrete number two or number one, I don't know. But I think, you know, like you said, you know, it's a big decision, and I don't mind mulling it over for a few days myself, you know.
Well, your engineer, Lee said your engineer is going to take a month to perhaps or several weeks to come up with biddable stuff. Well, is that right?
Yes, but we can't.
We have to tell him what our plan is.
Well, that's right. I think we
I don't know that he would take a month.
He's not coming up with a plan.
He's leaving in a month.
We
right.
decided
I'd like to have it done before.
Right. I think it's next week. Sure. I'm willing to do it, but I don't.
Yeah, it'd be nice to
mull
a couple
of days.
Let Lee start looking if you need us to make some calls or confuse anything.
Yeah.
Or we can happy to do that.
Lee's been good at thinking about
okay,
it.
Okay, let me talk. Then towards the end of the week, we'll warn a meeting for next week. We'll figure out, unless you're ready to set a day.
Oh, I just set a day or a morning or whatever works.
And yeah, I'm making the calls tomorrow morning. So.
Okay.
I would say earlier
say,
the better.
Just say Tuesday, and if I can't make
okay.
it, I'll try to use the electronic option.
Sure.
I would
Tuesday the 31st.
Yep. I can bring my, you know, I have this crystal ball. I can channel.
If I email a vote to the public record, is that okay?
You can vote by Skype now, if I remember correctly.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. How high in the air are you going to be?
Well, at that point, I'll say I'd be on the ground.
Oh, that's a good thing.
Otherwise, I'd get in trouble.
Good to know. Okay, so Tuesday, any time in particular? 5 o'clock?
The earlier the better.
4 o'clock? 9 o'clock?
3 o'clock?
Steve's calculating.
7:30.
Yeah. 7:30 is good.
Yeah. I don't mind you getting a deal here, but I don't want to lose much time.
What?
Yeah.
7:30 in the morning.
Yeah, 7:30 in the morning is great.
Yeah, whatever.
7:30?
It's fine.
I would love that.
Yeah,
7:30.
That's great.
Great.
You go flying in, right?
Hopefully I'll be done Monday. They'll catch me.
So we just need someone to remember their keys.
Not me.
Hey, can I just say thanks to Lee, too, for being open and exploring all these options. I know it's probably a pain in the neck. You want to go with your intuition, but I really appreciate it.
No, it makes me nervous because I don't want this big hunk of concrete in front of anybody's house, really. It was bad enough over Quarry Road, affected a couple individuals over there too, which we're pretty close to, and they ended up planting some bushes and flowers and different things too. So if we can do something and still get the longevity out of the bridge, I think it's good.
But I remember you said that when we talked about East West Road.
Yeah, you get to look at that one, right?
Oh, that's who's back there. Okay, hi.
All right, so let's move on. What else do we have? So, Lee?
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Right. Yeah, thank you very much. All right.
Thanks, Lee.
Great. Okay. Is there anything under correspondence for information that you feel compelled to discuss?
Are there any questions about the wastewater permits?
No, I don't think so.
No.
That's just regular routine notices from the state.
Okay.
The applications have been put in.
Okay,
then let's move on. A views article is due on June 11th. And that. Who'd like to write the
I did the last one, so.
It was so good.
Did you like it, Zeke?
Yes. Yes, I thought it was very good. Would you like to do another?
No, not right away. Don't even look at Steve.
You'll just give it to Maria, so don't worry.
No, when does Joe come back?
I was going to say, when does Joe get back?
He's flying back right this minute. All right, I think you put his name down.
Tradition is always
he'll tell us all about his bike trip.
We could do Joe. I could be the
alternative.
Yes.
What does it do, the 11th?
The 11th.
Would you like to?
Well, I've got one in this quarters too, so I don't know if I want to do another one right away. You know?
Well, just change the headline and just run the same article.
But I'll be, how about if I, you got a lot on your plate. If Joe can't do it, I think we should volunteer him, but I will be the backup.
Okay, great. Okay. Boy, that sounds good.
Daring to leave again, right?
I will.
I thought they said the service and never volunteered.
That's it. You're voluntold.
Okay, so we have the petition from the volunteer fire department. And which would I find out in any particular folder?
Unfinished business?
Unfinished business.
Okay, so this has been certified by our town clerk. And so. Let me go to my other page. We have, we have a timeline, a timeline that we need to follow in order to do this. But I was thinking that it would be the question that the fire department is looking for. Ask that the town either raise funds. So I was thinking if we could have it decided by Australian ballot. Mm-hmm. So everybody in town gets a say.
Right, and did you get a response about that?
Yes.
Can you tell us about that?
Sure, we can. If we decide to do that, we could this evening vote to have a special town meeting on, July 29th.
No, June
29th. June 29th, right, thank you. One of those J months. And we could, the article would be, shall the town of Dummerston vote on raising funds for the West Dummerston Volunteer Fire Department's center station replacement by Australian ballot? And so people would then say yes, they want to vote by Australian ballot, or no, they don't want to vote.
I see. So the town has to vote on how they're going to vote.
Yes, because we don't decide all our budget issues by Australian ballot now.
They have to make a special determination about the way in which we're going to vote.
Right, and we can't do both articles at the same time.
Got it.
And just so everybody gets it, or who watches the. Because I had to look a lot of stuff. Like, so a floor vote, that's the normal town meeting where just eyes and
ears.
And who's there votes,
right. Yeah.
Who's
last,
not there.
Last time we had a special town meeting, 30 people showed up.
Right. So a paper ballot would be if you're at the town meeting and someone can request a paper ballot, but that's still just only the people who are there at the meeting, and that's where you can get an actual tally. Just Australia ballot means the polls will be open from 7:30 a.m. to 7:30 p.m., everybody in town.
No, they probably would be. No. Oh, we're talking about a special town meeting. So this would be a floor vote because we don't do Australian ballot.
Oh, right. I'm just trying to explain what Australian ballot is. We're voting to have
so,
an Australian ballot. Which
30
would be
people could show up, or 130 people. And this would be the article that we'd consider.
Okay.
Shall we decide, the fire department's petition by Australian ballot.
And so it's those people who come to that meeting who would make that decision.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right. I was just trying
to
define what the different votes
Australian
are.
Ballot
are, yeah.
or not.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And if they say no, then we just go on and we have another special town meeting where everyone who shows up decides the
got it. That's issue. The piece I didn't understand. Okay.
Okay. Yes, Wayne.
What's the time frame on doing it that way? You will be June 29th?
Yep. We have to wait another at least 30 days So it would probably be August before we could then, you know, vote on that. There's a primary, state primary, on August 9th.
Right.
And so if we combined it with that, then we'd get the highest turnout probably.
Right.
But we could have, you know, we could go ahead and, you know, have a contingency where we're going, we could make assumptions that this is going to pass, and we could maybe, I'm talking to our town clerk, have done all the legwork with the, you know, lending institutions, decide who we're going to go to for a loan, or...
Yeah, you probably have to talk to your treasurer.
Yes.
About that.
Okay. That's speaking as a
former
treasurer.
You're not going to answer that now.
But yeah, you can have all that information
so
ready.
So we probably have everything ready, so when the vote came, if it was in favor of the article...
Right, after August 9th, right.
Yeah, then
yeah.
We'd be ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
Just sign the paper.
So, does it make a difference on the, if we did it August 9th, does it make a difference whether the town votes to do it by Australian ballot or not?
If, let's see, if they voted no, essentially...
The timing would be the same.
Yeah.
Okay, that... That was my question.
Yeah.
Is the timing the same whether we vote, whether the town votes to do it by Australian ballot or not?
Right.
The timing's the same.
The, from this, let's see, this was handed into the town clerk on May 11th.
Yeah.
And so we have 60 days to warn the special town meeting for this, or the,
uh-huh.
And then we have, once we warn
within
it,
60 days, we need to
we
warn
have
it.
To warn it. But then we have 30, we can warn it, and then it can't be less than 30 days from the date that we warn it, and it can't be more than 40 days.
Okay, 30 to 40
yeah.
day window.
So this
right.
fits in... some of the sharpest pencils in
yes,
have,
I see that.
Worked on
I see
this.
That.
And, so that falls within the time frame that we have to act on this. Yes?
I just have a comment, and I've not been at the meetings, but I've watched the videos. And I'm a little bit upset. I really liked Hughes wanting to talk to the fire department, and I really liked the board wanting to do... raise the money, try to raise the money before they went to the town. And I guess I have nothing against the fire department. I have nothing against their building a building. But I just thought that to go against what the selectmen asked asked the fire department to do, and for the fire department to not come in that second meeting afterwards and not communicate with Hugh, and then to come in the next meeting and with a petition that was totally different, I just felt kind of bad, because now it's going to, if the vote goes through, it's just going to be on our tax roll without any chance for people to make the bigger donations or whatever. And so that's just my feeling from watching it and my frustration, because I think you could have raised some of that money before without putting it on our taxes.
I think, you know, I'm not on the fire department, but I think their concern was they had a time frame
yeah,
that they
I realize
wanted to
that.
Work. And it is, so putting in a petition is, you know, that's, if you're not happy with what the select board does, that's...
It's legal.
Yeah.
But I liked Hugh's comment about backing it up from when the truck was going to come in. I mean, I really liked working backwards like that, and so I'll be quiet on this issue.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, thanks, Jody. I mean, I appreciate that. So, but that brings up a question for me, which is there any reason why we can't do a capital campaign during this window, and then it changes the amount that we're going to the town?
Right. There's no reason why we couldn't.
Uh-huh.
the 501(c)(3).
Right, that's
probably hasn't. Do you know what the?
No, it hasn't been finalized yet.
Okay. Okay.
And so, do you have any sense of the timeline, Wayne?
Last I knew, it was going to be another month or two. Uh-huh. I mean, we've been working on that for over 4 years.
Yeah.
And we thought we had it, and then we realized we didn't.
Yeah.
And so we've been about four years trying to get it. But one of the problems was the accountant that we had working on it put it off to the side, and it sat there for a year and a half before we found it out.
Yeah.
And so we hired a firm. I can't tell you the name of what it is either because I don't remember. But we've hired somebody, and it's right now. We just had to do a complete inventory of every piece of equipment we have and come up with a dollar amount of what it costs new and what it depreciated to now. So we are working on it.
Yes.
A quick comment on procedure. This, say the town votes to do this by Australian ballot.
Yes.
Will that be just for this item?
Yes, just for this.
Yeah.
Okay, it won't affect town meeting or
sharpest parliamentarians have worked through
just
the night
for that.
Okay,
great. Yeah. To make sure that we didn't.
Okay.
Change town meeting into completely. So,
but that when we were talking about that earlier, because that so this is just for this. Like personally, I would like to see any. I think you explained we can't just go into an Australian ballot because that's not our policy now. So we have to have a meeting to approve an Australian ballot for the next meeting. You know, it's the bureaucracy at its best. Like I said, protects us somehow. But I would like to see it. Every time something budgetary comes in requesting a special town meeting should be an Australian ballot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wish we could just capture that. That would not affect our March town meeting.
Right. Yes.
But I think any
special stuff.
Right. Anything that comes in via petition for a special town meeting or requiring a budget should be an Australian ballot. I just don't think it's fair for 30 people to show up and vote on $180,000.
Right.
Sure. But I don't know if we can write a warrant like that or not.
Well,
but
the LCT audit,
I
don't
believe so.
Okay.
We can.
From the conversations or the correspondence I've had with VLCT and Bob Fisher.
We might. I wonder if at town meeting we could have an article that would say special
might be able to.
Town meetings will be, you know, budget items, special towns meetings will be decided by Australian ballot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But it seemed like this was the best.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you wouldn't ruin town meeting, but
no,
just it was special.
Right.
So. Let's see. So if you'd like to,
I need to read how that goes.
Sure, let's see. Okay, yeah, do that.
So, all right, let's see how this goes. So I'll make a motion that we hold a special town meeting to present to the town. Wait, this is the fire department's. Okay, no. Shall the town of Dummerston vote on raising funds for the West Dummerston Volunteer Fire Department's center fire station replacement by Australian ballot?
I would second that motion.
Okay. Any discussion? I might, friendly amendment, that this would be subject to Bob Fisher's review, and if we have to change, you know, a word here or there,
mm-hmm.
that we do that, but the intent is to have a special town meeting.
I agree, yeah. As long as the intent is to have a special town meeting to present the Australian ballot option.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, and we'll use this wording unless Bob Fisher tells us to change it. Okay, any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And we, how about a motion to have this special town meeting on June 29th?
How will we have it on June 29th?
At 7:30.
At 7:30 p.m.
As per state statute.
As per state statute. Thank you. I knew that's what I wanted to say.
I knew you wanted to say that.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, any discussion? Where will we have it?
I can check on the Grange.
Okay. All right.
You don't have a polling over here anymore at the church?
No, this is for the special meeting when everybody comes to vote on that. No, that August 9th will be in the downstairs.
You can't do it at the school?
We could.
Well, the school's not in session.
Right.
Right, that's right, that's why I mentioned it, because I didn't think they're in session.
Okay, so we've got the day and the time, and we'll check on the venue.
Place to be announced, yeah.
Okay. A motion and a second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. Right, let's see, what else?
We need to go in the liquor.
Yes.
Control board.
Sure, where is that folder? How do you do such?
I'll move we recess as the select board and go into the liquor control board meeting.
A second?
I'll second it, sorry.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No. Okay. So here we are as the liquor commission. We have, this is a wedding reception at 223 Knapp Road in Dummerston. And they're going to be, what, is it 3,000 people? It's a 4-day event. Is that? No.
That's Woodstock.
Yeah, okay. 100 people expected, and this is Donovan's from Rockingham is requesting the catering license for that. And then there's one for a wedding reception at 707 Kipling Road. Dummerston on August 27th. All right, and that is the same place.
Oh, that one ends at 8:30. The times are both one's 4 to 11:30. The other is 2:30 to 8:30. Okay.
I need a motion before we have discussion.
Okay. I'll move. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, you got it.
No, I'll move we approve the applications for both venues.
And a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, now discussion. Okay, yes.
I do have a concern, and I know Paul talked to Jack today. With the Scott firm applications, there are certain limitations on time, music, drinking, and all this other things. I have not seen, Jack, where you've gone to the DRB so that we could talk about having those limitations put on as your closest neighbor, depending whether I like the music or not.
Any music I would understand, yeah.
Yeah, but and time, you know, all that things. And so because I have not seen that the permit has gone to DRB, because you're in a conservation zone, and that is a conditional use for, what do you call it?
Agritourism?
Yeah, agritourism. Thank you. I knew you'd know. Mm-hmm. Agritourism. And I'd kind of like to see, not that I'm saying not to do this, because I understand the reason for doing it for the farm, and I want to preserve the farm and all that things, but I would like to be able to discuss those kinds of issues.
Sure, that's totally understandable. As an agritourism event, I talked to Charlotte about, you know, what might be involved, and my understanding was, I know like 5 or 6 years ago, maybe it's longer, the town was trying to deal with agritourism and a permit process and conditions, and I didn't think that anything actually ever came of that.
It is in the zoning bylaw here, and it is under, where is it? It's in the conservation district, and agritourism is a conditional use.
And the conservation, so.
And I don't know what Charlotte told you, but that's in what I pulled up from the zoning bylaws.
All right. I'd be glad to talk to them about the conditional use.
Because they're not going to turn you down.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
The DRB's not.
And I would expect, you know, that I would totally want to adhere to, you know, what the neighborhood would want to see, you know, so I wouldn't want to cause any, you know, discomfort.
No, I know you wouldn't.
Led Zeppelin at 2 a.m.
Yeah,
or something, you know.
But
although,
because it was
maybe
on
at 10 at night, it would be okay.
Because it was on the agenda tonight, I went
sure.
to your website and
yeah.
you're advertising an event barn.
All right.
And
so you guys will work it out.
Yeah, well,
okay.
I think Jack will
go
be
on with our meeting if you don't mind.
Yeah.
We'll...
I just wanted to bring it up
yeah,
before
yeah.
you made
yeah.
before you made this motion to have something here before
yeah.
it had been decided.
Yeah. Okay.
Right.
Yes. Well,
can I ask a question? Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you first.
I just wanted to ask a question about the permit. What were the hours on those?
4 to 11.
4 to 11:30.
On which one?
4:30 to 8.
Jack, four in the afternoon to 11:30 at night.
Yeah.
Okay, because that's later than what.
Yeah, right. That's later than I didn't know what the.
Yeah,
was
yeah.
Say,
yeah.
It is later, and it's
yeah.
later than Scott Firms, I think, when you cut off the drinking amount on Scott Firms and the music.
And the other one is 2:30 to 8:30.
Yeah. Right. 2:30 in the morning.
What's the address of Jack?
You know, yeah, I'll actually translate this for you. Say we're written as 1600 and 2330.
And 1430 to 2030. So. The only thing I wonder about that is, for example, we have the Dummerston Farmland Protection Committee
yeah.
is going to have a fundraising dinner for the town, like there was a couple of years ago at Bunker Farm, where the local farms Dummerston would participate, which is a paying event, you know. And you know, do you call that agritourism? You know, is that
well, it's an agricultural thing.
Right.
But at one time, the select board talked about having a one-time event type of thing.
Would you like to vote on this motion?
Well, Jack's
more discussion.
No.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay. All right. Now, let's
might
see.
Want to ask
I'll
them
move
about
we
that.
Adjourn as a liquor control board and go back to our select board meeting in session.
I'll second that.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Now, could I ask a question?
Yes. Is it germane to our meeting?
Yes.
Okay.
At one time, the select board was considering doing an event, a one-time event permit. Did you ever do that?
No.
No.
Okay, that answers the question, Jack,
okay.
for that, but
good.
I wouldn't think that.
Maybe you should. Okay, other business. We received from the Grange a invitation, and this is to everyone in town, of course, but they specifically were asking the select board to the Memorial Day program, May 30th, at the Evening Star Grange, at 7 o'clock, and the American Legion Band is beginning, will be playing starting at 6:30.
This is Sunday?
Monday the 30th.
Monday
who's
the 30th.
Speaker?
Monday the 30th.
It doesn't say.
Oh, it doesn't say what the speaker is this time.
So that, and they would.
Obviously, Memorial Day, interesting. I went last year. I was not on the select board then, but I know there were, I think it would be very, I'm actually working that day. I'm not sure if I'm going to get back in time, but I would certainly go if I was. But I would encourage someone from the select board to try to attend. I think it would be the respectful thing to do for these people who have been putting on this thing for years and years to go to their program.
Okay.
And they do a great job.
Okay.
They do a great job.
Okay. Good. I'm actually getting the day off.
to do this?
Not to do this. I'm getting the day off.
Who gives you the day off?
Me. I'm taking the day off, so
great.
My dance card is open. Anybody else have any other business? Anybody else in the
room? I'll just back up. So after last week's meeting, Yeah, 2 weeks ago when Wayne and Rick showed up and I asked them to get in touch with me, I called Wayne, and then a few days later we were able to connect. So we haven't sat down or scheduled our meeting yet, but we have spoken once. So and then I've spoke with Lee for a bit and just try to figure out the venue, later go to the fire department and get, if I get some of the trustees, that would be probably the best way to do it. And you know, we got a, there's, now that we've kind of decided on the timeline, we've got a little bit of time, but I hope to do that certainly over the next 2 weeks or so. I'll get in touch with you and we'll try to get a time that both of us can get together.
Great. Okay. And I'm also still in touch with Rich Cagliano, talking about the Capital Paint campaign and the 501c3, and he's been very responsive.
Okay. I have one other item. You know, Wayne Emery is one of the animal control officers in Dummerston, and my understanding that he took a call at about 12:30 in the morning a week or so ago, went down and got this little dog from someplace on Route 5, and which I think is a kind of above and beyond the usual call of duty, and then spent most of the next day trying to locate the owners of this dog. So I think
we didn't find them. I ended up taking it to Humane Society.
Oh, I thought you were going to say taking it home and keeping it.
No, no.
Thank you, Wayne.
Yeah, I really
applaud him.
Yeah. So
I've been lucky over the years. I've only taken one animal over there. I've found out who owned them. And end up getting them to come get them.
Yeah, that's great.
So I'd just like to say on the camera, I guess Wayne is
also the animal control officer.
I was in dreamland. Sorry.
So after midnight, call him, you're saying.
if you want some response.
Yeah.
All right. Yes.
I just wanted to make sure that you know that you all are invited, and we hope you come. The Historical Society is having an open house on June 12th from 3 to 5. We're dedicating the bunker, the new bunker room, and we will have refreshments and an official dedication. And Chuck Fish has taken pictures of the addition from the beginning. We have old pictures of the building, so there's a display of all of Chuck's pictures. And I hope you come and join us, because you are such a part, a helpful part,
right,
of our getting...
Right, we get to use our bathroom now.
Yeah, we get to use your bathroom. You get to use our space for meetings.
Well, we've tried, and you've turned us down. So
I haven't turned... Well, we were a mess at one time.
This is an issue for us.
We were a real mess. We didn't want
to
go in there.
Put a lock on that bathroom door.
Well, it's cleaned up now, and it will be cleaned up.
Okay.
And, of course, as maybe not all of you know, the property the building sits on belongs to the town. And the building belongs to us, so it's kind of a...
Do you need anyone to cut a ribbon or anything?
I don't know what they're doing. I'm not sure. I'm not part of that. And but we're hoping that Sam and Jency...
Cocktails.
That Sam will be able to come. He's not been well, and we're hoping that he will be able to come and be part of it. So we would love to have you come. I think you're going to get an official invitation, but I just thought while we were on the camera... that we would invite anybody who wants to come.
The cocktails, that. And
we're not having cocktails, but we do have food and drink, but they're not alcoholic.
Drink was.
Do you have an event permit for
that?
Nice.
No, we don't. I mean, maybe we better get it.
Is there any other business to come before this august board?
Will we adjourn?
Second.
Hey, thanks for
all
much.
All right.
Thank you, Jim.